cost way.
There.
Yeah.
Nice. I speak.
That sounding better now? Maybe Murray could put in the chat if he can hear us now. Okay, Murray Hunt says yes, so.
Okay.
Excellent. So it's great. It's great. There's a lot of, if you haven't been in the room lately, there's a lot of technology going on here.
The laptop. Just need to.
No, we don't.
But it is coming really.
Talking now? Okay. Start again. Yeah. So it's great to be back here. I'm trying to remember the last presentation I would have made here, probably CGIL Seminar at some stage, but we left here in 2013, so it's almost been 10 years. It'll be 10 years in November. And so lots of memories. I defended my thesis standing right about here. And I'll talk a bit about that at one stage a little bit later in the presentation. But so the AGBU is the Animal Genetics and Breeding Unit, and affectionately known as AGBU. So people call it AGBU, and thought I would start there a little bit because part of my, you know, took advantage of a trip that I was coming to the Americas, although I realized Brazil isn't right next door to Guelph, but relative to Australia, while you're in the same time zone, just come a little bit north and go home from there. So that was the idea of the trip and come back. And I think after the world's kind of been locked down for a couple of years, where I am here in Australia, we've always had a lot of visitors and people on sabbatical and things like that. Has been a pretty desirable place for people to come. And I think we need to kind of get the world moving again and thinking about it. So that's kind of one of my ideas today is let's think about exchanges and what opportunities might be out there. So where is I think I didn't start with where Australia is. I think everyone could figure that out, but where AGBU is relative to Australia. So it's on, like a lot of Australia, it's on the East Coast. Most of Australia kind of lives up in this region.
Sorry,
and
you have to bump it again. It's not sharing property, sorry.
Okay.
Unfortunately. We're not sharing on it. Shared on this screen, so why should be, was it okay?
No, it's still your other screen.
Oh, it was
you're sharing on the screen, no?
Steve, we just can't hear you. I think you're on mute.
Still cannot hear.
I haven't seen it blow -5 yet. It snowed once and people ran out and took pictures because it's gone like in an hour or something. So it's not a compared to winter, compared to Canadian winter, it's not much of a winter. But so it's kind of, they call it the New England. Sound works now. Now we can hear. Okay, perfect. Okay, so this is, AGBU is a little bit different. So there is like an animal science department at the university, and there's animal breeders there. Like, hey!
All right, sir.
It's old home week. Yeah. So there's basically, there's an animal science department. You might know Julius Vanderwerf or Sam Clark, animal breeders that are there. John Gibson used to be in this department, is in that department. AGBU is a little bit different. We're actually not just the university. We're a joint venture between the university and the state government. And so it's a research institute on the campus, but the people are, most of the people in this picture are all kind of what we call research academics. So they're doing research, but they're not doing teaching. So, you know, some of them get up through the ranks and become a professor, assistant, associate professor type of thing. But they're not teaching. So it's all full-time research for industry application. So AGBU started in 1976, and that was kind of, I think, old pictures. We've got 4 people in it or something, but there's 21 PhDs in the building. And maybe about 30 people in total, all working on mostly genetic evaluation work around sheep and beef cattle is the biggest contract, but they're doing some work in shrimp, or called prawns in Australia, honeybees. There's a project in honeybees starting up, and some work in plants, which is obviously it's the animal genetics and breeding unit, but there's like everything else in the world, the plant breeders are more interested in animal breeding tools and things. So that's it's a bit different than your typical academic department because it's very applied in terms of what we deliver is actually what generates the breeding values, which is what breeders select their cattle on. So, Brian, what'd you pay me for this effort? $2,200. Do I hear 24? So you probably can't see very well in the picture. This is a heifer that actually was at a sale recently, and it was a catalog sale, so she wasn't there physically. She just had this picture. She's in the catalog with the description and things. She's never been to a show. She's never won any ribbons. You know, what would you pay for that heifer? And to be honest, it's not a very flattering picture, I guess, if you don't look at beef cattle all the time, but you wouldn't, you know, it's not that eye-catching. But to kind of round it out a little bit more, I'll tell you that she's a Wagyu heifer. And she's from this sire here. You know, he's good for carcass traits. He's fairly popular. You know, that's not a whole lot more go on. She's 13 months old and she's got horns. She's not polled. So she's a full blood Wagyu heifer. And I can tell you that she has basically a complete suite of breeding values. And just to give you an idea where she ranks in the population, she's in the top 1% for marbling and ribeye area, which are big economic drivers for Wagyu because it's all about the carcass, really. And so she's in the top 1% for the economic indexes for the breed. So what did someone pay for this heifer with that information and a picture in a catalog? They haven't even seen the heifer yet.
I think the price went up a bit.
With the numbers?
Well, yeah, from the $2,200.
Right, okay, well, we got up to $2,200, yeah. But I don't know, anyway, she sold for $400,000. And it made the news because that was a record in the country. And typically the records are all set by bulls that might have won a show somewhere or something, you know, a bit more track record than that. But I guess I use it as an example of, you know, today we're talking about what's some advancements in livestock breeding. Why would someone dip into their pockets with $400,000 for a heifer? It's the Yulong Investment Corporation. So there's this is the investors here on that side, and these people, there's owners in the middle, and the Wagyu Association people on the other side. But basically, there's an investment corporation that's basically breeding Wagyu cattle. So that heifer's probably, I don't know how many embryos they would get out of her by now, but that she's probably right into some kind of an embryo program, right? But still, I have to ask myself, well, based on information, would you actually make that investment? But the data is contributing to this accuracy here. So she's actually fairly accurate for all traits, including carcass traits. And all she has analyzed on herself is a 200-day weight, which is like nothing. You know, there's no data, I would say almost no data. But she's been genotyped. So the point is, she's not measured for any carcass traits, but there's 7,000 other Wagyu out there that are genotyped and phenotyped for carcass traits. And so that's the reference population. And I guess if we think about what's been the advancements in animal breeding in my career, this is the big thing. It's the fact that we can actually come up with a fairly accurate breeding value in an animal based just on DNA. And I would say when I stood here in this spot to defend my thesis, I didn't anticipate that would be the case. You know, people said we would be there someday, but it seemed like a long way off at that point in time.
Why don't they report percentiles?
There is a percentile table. Okay. There'll be a percentile table for the breed type of thing. Yeah. So I'd say this has been the biggest disruptive innovation in livestock genetics in my career, for sure. In 2005, when it first became available, we were kind of asking the question, can we make genomic selection work in livestock? And then people at the time, like Flavio and others on the dairy side, rapidly had, you know, 4,000 bulls or so with that had samples on plus genotypes for the first iteration of genomic selection. Something like that, right? So and quickly launched the breeding values in 2009. And then on the beef side, we're sitting there looking at that and saying, well, that all proved out. It all validated. It works. Can we make it work in beef cattle? And today we're sitting here, the rest, all the above is history. I think if you went to the World Congress, there's any serious livestock breeding population today is using genomic selection, right? Whether you're breeding sheep or beef cattle, dairy cattle, chickens, turkeys, what have you. And I was, I guess, reflecting back, and Larry's not in the room, but Larry wrote this paper in 2006, right? In 2006, he predicted, so the SNP chip came out, genomic selection isn't here yet, we've got the theory, you know, what could this mean to the dairy breeding industry? And he predicted they could double their rate of genetic gain with the technology. And these results here from Canada in dairy cattle is basically, Larry was right, but Larry was also not quite right, because they didn't double the rate of progress. They basically, for these indexes, should do in 2.4 times what they used to do. So he actually underestimated it a little bit. And I think at the time, when he said, well, we're going to double the rate of genetic progress in dairy cattle, you say, well, geez whiz, you know, dairy cattle are making a lot of progress already. How much faster can they go? Kind of like, how much faster can this Porsche go? But it's not that they've actually increased milk yield that by 2.4 times. They've actually changed a lot of traits like fertility, which has an impact on their index. And through genomics, they've been able to turn that around. And that's obviously the story of a lot more people here in Canada. It's not really my story, but I think it's a great example. What's it look like in other species? So in sheep in Australia, this is kind of the same graphs. It's not as dramatic, but still it's about a 50% increase in the index. since they've launched genomic selection in merino sheep. And, you know, there's not much of a merino sheep industry in here in Australia, or sorry, here in Canada, but it's a big deal. It's a big deal for Australia.
Just to comment on the history, I think Larry was off.
Larry what?
Because he said Dobri, right? I'm born in Dobri.
Yeah, 2 point.
Because it was based on our first result with the 10,000 markers based on the paragraph SNP chip. That exists just for
right. Time. Yeah, yeah.
Right. In that year, 2016, we had the first result.
With the 10K.
10K. And of course, the prediction was lower, the accuracy.
Right.
So I think that explains why Larry based his kind of simulation, what would happen. So there is a history there. He explained why he was
a little bit lower.
A little bit lower.
Yeah. So Larry's right on again. So he was, yeah, yeah, that's it. Yeah, yeah. So I'll share some results. So after being in New Zealand for 3 years, I was with American Angus for 4 years. And this is the team that's there, processing a lot of genotypes. And they provided some information I'm sharing with you today. So I'd like to give credit to the people that are still there and producing these results. So genomic selection, of course, is not magic, right? And I think sometimes the breeders think it's magic. The breeders sometimes think, well, the geneticists they're sitting there with a big recipe book of genes and their effects, you know, and we could look at the code and we can look up those genes and come up with some formula for an animal. But that's actually, and we have to come back to the breeders and say, it's all based on your data, right? So I've had, at American Angus, I'd have breeders that say, well, I like the genomics. I want to see the genomic only value because I don't want to see it with the phenotypes because people cheat with their phenotypes. So but you can't change the DNA. The DNA doesn't lie. And I'm like, but the DNA prediction is based on the phenotypes. It's all the same. It's all the same system. So a big part of the messaging to the breeders is we got to keep the phenotypes coming in, right? So far, we've built this system based on breeders collecting all the data, and we got to keep that going. So one of the big problems, not I don't know how big of a problem it is, but it is definitely a trend, is breeders are kind of slowing down on measurements for some traits. So in American Angus, for example, I don't think I show that result later, but there's 2.7 million ultrasound records. They used to come in at about 100,000 records a year, maybe even up some in the earlier days was well over 100,000. Now they're getting down under 80,000. So there's just a steady decrease down. And breeders basically say, well, and I've done the validation work there to show the value of genomics, you know, how much accuracy do you get with your phenotype, how much accuracy do you get with genomics, how much accuracy with both. And the answer is you don't get any more accuracy with both. So once you genotype them, you can scan them if you want, but you don't get any more accuracy. So the breeder's like, well, why am I paying this money doing all this work? And you have to explain to them, well, actually, someone's got to do the phenotyping or we're going to lose accuracy over time. So I think that's the big challenge. It's great. We've arrived at this situation where we can get this accuracy with genomic selection, but the phenotyping can't stop. And I think with it's worthwhile pointing out with some of these traits, you know, yeah, there's millions of growth traits, but there even for some hard to measure traits like feed intake, here's 34,000 measurements, 140,000 heifer pregnancy observations, over 300,000 foot score records, and some of these harder to measure traits. And finally, I'll talk more about the genotyping in a few minutes. But taking American Angus and trying to do the graph that we saw here earlier for the sheep and the dairy cattle, presented in a little bit different way. But this is how much gain we're doing in weaning weight pre-genomics, and this is how much gain. So just seeing the increase, and you say, well, but milk's actually going the wrong way. But actually, Angus breeders generally don't want more milk. So it's still going up, but it's just not going up as fast. And I think a lot of breeders would say that's a good thing because they don't want to put, they're worried that they're actually a bit too much milk. So they want to kind of put the brakes on milk a little bit. Carcass weight's going up, ribeye's going up. I'll come back to marbling. Fats, we don't want to put on more external fat. So that's actually a good result. We want more marbling. But marbling hasn't changed much. And so I'll put Brian on the spot just to give me an answer why he thinks maybe marbling has not increased.
I don't know.
Yeah, so marbling's going up, but something happened in around 2010 in the Angus population. No, so this we don't know for sure, but this is kind of a theory, right? So we can see a blip in the genetic trend after 2010. So it was going up and then it went like there's like a sawtooth in the genetic trend. But what happened in American Angus around 2010? Genetic recessives. So there's a few genetic recessives that came out in Angus, and the association basically had a fairly hard line on the fact that you couldn't register progeny, you couldn't register carriers, period. And if a bull was a carrier, basically he couldn't register any more progeny. So there was some bulls, and the reason that they identified the recessives to begin with is because there was some animals were being heavily used because they had great marbling. Right. They were the breed leaders in terms of marbling and ribeye. And so they were kind of a bit of inbreeding going on in terms of, you know, but they were carriers. So then they were their sons and all their progeny and stuff were kind of pulled from the population. So it caused basically a dip in the trend. And that's why. So it is marbling is still moving ahead and it should respond just like the rest in terms of it'd be a great one to respond with genomic selection. But we think that's why we see that trend.
Have you looked at that in just like the last 5 years, Steve?
We could actually, if you want to look at the trends for Angus, they're actually on, they plot, they've actually got an Excel file online. I just don't have, it'd be interesting. You could plot it. But where are we at in terms of accuracy in Angus? You know, it's a bit different for all the traits, obviously with different heritabilities and one thing or another, but you'll see here generally 10 plus progeny equivalence is what you get for a genotyped animal. So that's for something like, say, milk here at 35 progeny that, you know, for, you know, a cow is never going to have 35 progeny that are daughters that you get, that you wean a calf from. So for cow accuracy, it's really high. And even for bull accuracy, it's pretty high just with genomics. So what's happened to genotyping in Angus? And this is, I've got a lot of different graphs on here, but generally they register about 300,000 animals a year. And this past year, they did just on 200,000 genotypes. So about 2/3 of calves today are registered, and they have 1.25 million genotypes in the database. So when I first came to Angus in 2016, they had 250,000 genotypes. And in 2016, that was a big deal. That was, you know, I was quite shocked. I didn't realize they had that many. That was 2016. Since then, they've basically added a million genotypes. The other thing I wanted to show with this graph is just the ratio of bulls and females. So there's actually a pretty even split. So there's lots of females being genotyped, which is a good thing because we don't want the breeders just genotyping the males because it might just they just want to use it for marketing purposes and not actually using it for selection. So to get those carcass traits on the females that they're using is important. I think it's so the fact that they're genotyping lots of females is a good thing. So we had actually a colleague of mine, we were talking about genomic selection in beef cattle and whatnot. And he basically said, so do you see a decrease in the age of the parents? And I'd never looked at it before. So for this so I just gave this a talk with some of these components for this embryo transfer talk. And so it's interesting. The cows have actually been drifting down a little bit over time, but most dramatically. So that's 2010. When they launched the first genomically enhanced DPDs in Angus, and we see basically a nice decrease in the age of the sires that are used. So this it kind of proves that people are using the technology because the whole increase in a lot of the increase in progress in dairy cattle has been the fact that you can use a sire younger. So instead of waiting for a sire to actually have a lot of, so carcass traits are really important. Like Brian said, he would expect marbling to go up because it's a very economically relevant trait. But if you want an accurate proof for marbling, well, then you have to wait till you get some progeny. Or now with genomics, we don't have to wait. So, and the evidence is there that they're actually using less sires. We did a joint, we were talking earlier with the grad students and postdocs and things, and you know, what did you do in Angus? And but a lot of what I did was coordinating research projects with other groups. So Christian Meltek at North Carolina State University had a a PhD student, and he looked at inbreeding in Angus. And so there's a paper published, and you can read all about it. But basically, we're seeing a slightly different result than we see in dairy cattle, and the fact that we're actually with since genomics, we've actually got more diversity in Angus than less. Because one of the questions from breeders is, well, is this going to cause us to, everyone's going to chase the same bull and we'll have inbreeding problems? But it's the opposite as this age has come down. And I think if you look in sire catalogs or whatever, you see more diversity that, you know, the AI studs are actually reaching into some herds that they didn't reach into before for some genetics, because they've got some confidence there with the genomic testing. So that's, I think, a good news story. The other one I think is interesting is this orange line is what I want to kind of draw attention to. And this is all about it's an index that's got, it's kind of an all-purpose index. It's got the maternal traits in there and the terminal traits all weighted together. And this is, so it's, that's going up over time. So that's good. So people are making progress. But this orange graph is actually, it's the standard deviation of the index values for the heifers born or the females born in each of those years. And it's going up as well. So what's happened? So more females are being genotyped. There's more recording going on for some of the traits that go into this index, like heifer pregnancy, foot score, docility. And with that, then we pull the EPDs apart more, and then that creates more standard deviation in the indexes. But that's important because we see more spread. We're better identifying the top genetics. So, you know, we can come up with economic indexes, but if nobody records anything and no one genotypes anything, everyone's just average. So everyone gets a number, but they're just clustered around the mean, and you can't pick the best female. So that I think is also evidence that things are happening. In Australia, what's happening with genotyping? The same trend in America. It's not on the same, it's not to the same degree. You know, they don't have millions. But in sheep, even in sheep now, the merino analysis has over 250,000 genotypes for sheep. And in Angus, they're over 250,000. There are over 100,000 records in Wagyu. I didn't mention that earlier, but in terms of breeds, you know, if you look at the breeds here in America, you might, you know, Angus registers more animals than basically all the other breeds combined. But in Australia, Wagyu is gaining ground fairly significantly in the country. Hence why somebody wants to pay $400,000 for a heifer. So, yeah.
Why Wagyu are so popular in Australia?
Well, I've had it explained to me in different ways. Because it's in contrast to the United States, right? So Wagyu hasn't taken off in the US like it has done in Australia. So Australia's a big export market. So it's generally a lot about the exports. And obviously Japan, Korea, those kind of high-end markets. So there's also a lot of there's actually quite a bit of Japanese investment in the supply chain. So there's the big feed lots are actually owned by Japanese companies. So they've kind of have it tied together, I guess you'd say. Something else, and this was pointed out to me in America, was the reason Wagyu's not so successful in America is because certified Angus beef is so successful. Because they've certified Angus beef, it's basically dominates the market. And maybe for the average American consumer, that beef is good enough, right? They're selling Wagyu carcasses for, like, obviously there's a huge range in terms of the quality and everything else, but on a kind of an average basis, good Wagyu carcasses are like $8,000 a piece. So then you think as a breeder, it wasn't that many years ago, if I had an $8,000 average on my bull sale, I would have been happy, more or less, you know, just selling steers. Mind you, they're on feed for quite a long time, so it takes a lot of dollars to get them to that level. But still, so it's quite interesting. Anyways, we'll talk a bit about some kind of methane traits, because that's, well, I'll touch on that in a little bit. But so what can we focus on now in beef cattle with genomics that we couldn't do before? It actually lets us start to get at some of these hard to measure traits. So on the dairy cattle side, you know, they're starting to move fertility. That is great. But on the beef cattle side, Because we don't have to measure the actual cows and bulls we want to select for the trait, we can measure some other cattle and put together a prediction equation. So I'll use a couple examples from Angus. The one here is heat, basically adaptation to heat, and one of the adaptations anyways, and it's EPD called hair shedding. So obviously in Canada today, cows have got a nice winter coat on. And once the Toronto Maple Leafs start the playoffs, it will start to warm up, and then cows will start to lose their winter coat, right? But there's variation in that. So some cows shed off. You can't really see very well on the picture here, but this cow's totally slick in terms of she doesn't have any of her winter coat on anymore, and this one's carrying her full winter jacket still. So you go out. You basically go out into the pasture when about half the herd is shed off the coat, and you score the cows, and you'll score some that are ones, and you score some cows that are fives, and some in between on a one to five scale. So it's somewhat confounded a little bit in the US. When I first got there, I was a little bit driving down the road, you know, and I'd see cows standing in water, like a pond. Like we have a pond here in Ontario, right? But these cows are just up to their backs, like hippopotamus, just kind of filling this pond with black Angus cows. And I'd never really seen that before. Like, that's really weird behavior. But the problem is, in this whole region here, it's what they call the fescue belt in the U.S. So it's an endophyte that is in the ryegrass, and that endophyte is basically toxic to cattle. So, and they don't vasodilate properly, so they're basically hot because they're not sweating properly. So so heat is a big, it's tied up with this fescue toxicosis problem. It's all a bit convoluted, but actually being on hot fescue, they call it hot fescue, being on hot fescue with a full winter coat in Missouri, where it's like 100 Fahrenheit, 40 Celsius, and 100% humidity. It's a tough job for white guys like me, more or less black cattle. So it's a project we had with University of Missouri, and there was some historic genotypes data from at Angus from previous research projects together, and we had a graduate student working on this, and I think I'd kind of point that out that. She was doing her PhD at the University of Missouri. Harley Durbin is her name. And then she came and did an internship with us at Angus. And so I just pulled the whole idea about exchange and students, you know, a call for internships might be open at the moment at Angus. I don't know exactly when it closes. Maybe it's passed, but every year they bring in now two students, and they've been really good students and really great projects. She was able to take her project then and kind of turn it around, because before she had a lot of research data. By the time the summer was over, we actually had a research breeding value that we could show people. So encourage you to take advantage of those opportunities when they come around. The other one, and this is a bit of a different trait. We don't have to worry about it too much here in Guelph. But, and I know Angela's actually worked with the Colorado State team, and Angela's online, but she's worked with the Colorado State team years ago on some of the earlier data in this for this trait. But it's PAP is pulmonary arterial pressure, and it's basically blood pressure for cows. And I guess I like to use this as an example of this is a hard trait, right? So if we can make genomic selection work for this trait, then we can make it work for other traits. Scoring hair shedding, you know, producers can do that themselves. This is fairly intensive intervention by veterinarians. So this is where, Colin, you said you were going to pause. Can you pause the recording?
Yes.
All you people online can see, but it's breeders had been scoring or getting this trait measured for a number of years, going back to the 80s. The issue is at altitude, if you've ever known anybody that had heart problems,